Kaytranada, congratulations on your recent Polaris Music Prize win. And welcome to the Red Bull Music Academy in Montreal.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. I think we should set the tone by listening to some music first, because I think people want to hear
definitely
what it is you've done. So I'm going to play my favorite song from your latest album. So that was Leave Me Alone from 99.9%, featuring Shay Leah, who's a singer from here in Montreal. When did you make that track?
I made that like 2 years ago.
So this was before you signed to XL, because you signed to XL in 2014.
Yeah. I think it was around the time that I was signed to XL. And I always send a lot of beats to Shay Leah because she's working on the project as well. And, you know, she came up with the demo of Leave Me Alone. And, you know, it's just little lyrics, you know, just ideas and stuff. So I thought it was really hot, you know, just, you know, not to have a lot of lyrics on it and just let the beat take over. So that was what we pretty much did.
How different did it sound as a demo from this version that we just heard now?
Not really. It's not that different, pretty much. I think I just add a little more of extra things in the second chorus of it, like in the second drop.
What did you add?
Like organs and, you know, strings and the sample. So it's pretty much that.
You work with a lot of people on this album. Craig David, Vic Mensa, Little Dragon, Kareem Riggins, who is, what, like a personal hero of yours? I think a lot of people here would want to know how you end up working with dream collaborators on your first album.
Oh, man. I think it's only by Twitter, you know, Twitter following, you know, knowing that they love your music back. So for me, it's always awkward to just, you know, ask someone who doesn't know me, you know, to just work on with me on music. So pretty much, like, it's people that I met before, you know, overseas or whatever, on tour. And, you know, knowing that they love my music, and that makes me more comfortable to work with them. So, yeah.
How did you meet Craig David?
Oh, Craig David. I didn't meet him before. I think he followed me on Twitter before. Then I was like, oh, my God, Craig David's following me. Like, because, you know, I've been listening to his first album, Born to Do It. My sister was, like, bumping, 7 days. And, you know, Walking Away is one of my favorite songs from him. And, you know, just knowing by the fact that he, like, likes my music and he asked for beats, like, we have, like, 5 demos that we worked on. And everything sounds crazy. It's pretty much only choruses and, you know, Got It Good came with that. And I really asked him to use Got It Good for the album. And he said yes, so.
For his album.
Yeah, for my album, my bad.
Sorry, but you do have stuff coming up for a new project that he's working on.
Yeah, pretty much. We have another song called Sink or Swim, and Got It Good. He used it for his album, his upcoming album coming up Friday.
It's coming out on Friday?
Yeah, Follow My Intuition. That's the name of the album. Coming up Friday in the UK and stuff like
Exclusive.
That.
Exclusive. So what does that interaction look like, say, with someone like Craig David? You guys are in the studio together, or are you sending files back and forth?
It's pretty much that. Like, this is how I work pretty much with most of the artists. Like, I send beats, you know, and then some of them don't reply. Most of them don't reply back because they rather work at the studio, and, you know, stuff happens more in the studio, and I understand that. But me, like, I get to, like, find more of my ideas when I'm home and when I'm, like, in my own, you know, comfort zone. And studio is not really comfortable for me sometimes. But, yeah, it's pretty much I send beats back and forth, and they send, like, ideas, like, you know, or even, like, demos or, you know, everything around it. And I judge it if it's hot or not, you know. So it's pretty much that.
So you're the judge of it?
Pretty much.
Okay. you know, I think one of the things that's drawn people to 99.9% is your grasp of a variety of genres. I think it was an interview with Sway, the radio host. He said that listening to this album made him feel like he was back in the mid-90s or something like that. What was your reference point for a track like Leave Me Alone?
I mean, I don't know. The thing is, like, with Leave Me Alone, I was really inspired by, you know, like, Afro House. And, you know, at the time, it was, I really liked, you know, all the dances that came with, like, the African music and, you know, everything around it. So,
you mean, like, modern African music?
Yeah, modern African music. Like, today, like, you know, Logobi and, you know, Azanto, all that type of stuff, you know. And I really wanted to make that type of music so I could dance to it, I guess. So, yeah, that's what inspired me to do Leave Me Alone. And I have other tracks that has the same vibe, but I don't think they're going to see the light of day. But, yeah.
You're very specific about dance music. You've talked about this. And I mean music that is for dancing, not music that might just be classified as dance music. Where did you get those ideas from?
I get those ideas because I guess it was like in me or something. Because I started with making hip hop beats, and then there was like a phase in 2009 or something when I was in high school. I was making EDM, like pure EDM. All the house, you know, David Guetta was like a huge inspiration, like for a little time. So, you know, all those songs in 2009 where EDM was like starting to get, you know, on the pop radio and stuff like that. My sister was listening to a lot of that type of music, you know, and she wanted a mix as well for her cars, you know, so I made mixtapes for her.
What were on those mixtapes?
What
songs were on those mixtapes?
Like, you know, No Stress and stuff like that. You know, like, I don't know if you know that song, like Lauren Wolf or something. David Guetta, a lot of, like, you know, Memories with Kid Cudi.
Like
Black Eyed Peas, you know, like, when Black Eyed Peas went, like, full electro. You know, I fuck with that. I really like that. My bad for the lyric. But I really like, when Black Eyed Peas turned to, like, it was really interesting to see them try, you know, EDM house or pop music. So it was all that type of music at the time that was like something new or something, you know, interesting. So, and then I discovered Justice, which was way more different, you know, way more weird, way more like greedy, raw, like sort of like how Madlib does it with, you know, his beats and stuff like that. So it was just that Justice was doing like, I guess, house and, you know, dance music, we'd say. But very with an art form, so I was inspired by that. But that's all, like, the dancey stuff came with the idea of just making dance music. So that's where it comes from.
In an interview, you said that the first song that made you cry was "No Woman, No Cry" by Bob Marley when you were 3 years old. Do you remember the first song that made you want to dance?
I mean, if I go back to memory, I don't know if I remember the first song that made me dance, but no, I can't really remember. Like, maybe like a little Bow Wow song, like Take Me Home, that made me really want to do the Harlem Shake and, you know, all those type of music around 2002. Like all the hot dances, you know, the Right There and the Crip Walk and all that type of stuff.
Crank was insp- That.
Yeah. Crank That was a little later. Yeah. I was not a fan of that, but my brother was like playing these songs all the time, and those two was like doing all the dances, and, you know, I know the dances by heart because of them, because they were doing in like my face all the time, you know, like, so yeah. I respect it so much.
But, do you have a process now for kind of testing out the danceability of your tracks? Do you dance to them? Do you watch other people dance to them?
Not really. I just think I have it in me, you know, like, it's just that I feel it in like the back of my neck, or it has to be like groovy and like, it made me feel like some type of way, you know. It has to be, I have to like have fun too while I'm making a beat and, you know, make it soulful, make it groovy, you know. I'm trying to find always like the key to like will make me like move, or what will make people dance at my shows, or you know, any party that's happening. So that's like why I want to make dance music, I guess.
I want to talk some more about the music that you love growing up, but I also want to play this song to jog some memories, I think. So what was that song?
Candy Shop, 50 Cent.
And you guys were laughing. You and your brother were laughing. Why were you laughing?
We were laughing because when I was eight, I was like 12. 10. Nah, I was just getting to like high school. But yeah, anyways, like I was like before teenage years, like we had the sound recorder in this Windows thing. Mm-hmm. And you could like just record like whatever sound memos. And me and my brother used the Candy Shop instrumental and just like did the karaoke on it, you know. Just in terms of like the fact that we could perform music, it was like something crazy for us. We were just recording like from the microphone and, you know, singing all the lyrics, freestyling over it, you know. Freestyle, but we're not saying the word village. We were just like saying blah 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 blah, 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 take it to the candy shop. But you know, that's how we're doing it, and we didn't know what we were doing at the time. That's what was crazy about it. We were just like recording, trying to like be rappers at the time, you know, like trying to be hot or something. But yeah.
So rapping came first for you before making beats.
Yeah, I guess rapping, but you know, mumble raps. Today it's like it's very familiar, but but yeah, I used to do that way back a long time ago.
When did you make the switch to making beats?
I made the switch when I was like 14. I think I was into DJing first. Mm-hmm. So I discovered virtual DJ. Just seeing my cousin, like a close cousin of mine, was just like just showing me virtual DJ, and just the fact that you could digitally scratch records, I was like, oh snap, like you can actually like scratch samples. And you know, that really blew my mind, because like I really didn't see vinyls ever in my life, you know. And I didn't have a turntables. Like I think like my dad left, like, you know, my dad left the crib, because like my parents got separated, so we didn't have the accessible like turntable or none of that. So just seeing the fact my cousin was like scratching digitally, I was like so like interested to just like try to mix. So I was just like digitally mixing on virtual DJ, and then I learned about looping, like looping drums and looping samples, and then you just combine that and it just makes a whole brand new beat. So I was like, man, I can make my own beats, you know, like I just have to control it, you know. I didn't want to use drum loops for the rest of my life. So my brother introduced me to Fruity Loops a bunch of times. I installed and uninstalled like over 3 times, because I didn't know how it worked. And then my brother was like, man, you just have to do this like that. And I was like, oh, okay. And then I could start making beats from then, like since I was 14.
What did those beats sound like?
Those beats sounds like pretty much, I think the first beat I remember was like some trap, like very hard drums and like normal stock sounds, like very experimenting. Like, yeah, I wish I had the beats with me, but damn, I have the CD at home. I wish I could have showed you, but yeah.
And are you still using Fruity Loops now?
Yeah, sometimes.
So do you want to tell everyone what you're using?
I'm using Machine now, that with Fruity Loops. But Fruity Loops is pretty much for sampling. It's more easier. But with Machine, I guess, like, I just learned about the new update, so I use Fruity Loops less now. But, yeah.
We were jamming a little bit earlier, playing the drums, and you had a piano at home growing up. Are there any other instruments that you play?
Not really. I didn't play other instruments other than piano. I wish I did, you know, like we all wanted to play like different instruments and everything and all that. But I guess we couldn't get like the money for it. Well, my dad really like bought a piano for Christmas one time and we were like mind blown, like, oh snap, we got a real piano. It's not just a keyboard and an electric like keyboard. But yeah. It's just that our teacher at the time was not teaching us how to play. He was teaching us how to play songs and not, like, the techniques. And, like, it's... I don't think he was doing the right lessons and stuff. He was just only teaching us how to play songs and everything around it, like, reading music and all that. And I don't know. We didn't get to, you know, learn that. But that's why I kind of, like... I didn't like piano, in, like, for a while when I was young. And I hate myself for that. I'm like, damn. But... I guess we couldn't pay for piano lessons anymore because, like, we didn't have, like, the money. Like, my parents was going to a lot. So, yeah, that's how we stopped playing the piano.
Would you take piano lessons now?
Hell yeah, I would. But the thing is, like, I went back to, like, learn piano when I was, like, 18 years old, too. I had, like, a little small class. And my mom was paying for it, and then my mom couldn't pay for it anymore. So, you know. I'm like, damn, but, you know, it's life, I guess.
Something you talk about a little, and, you know, we can get into this when we play some of your remixes, okay. But you've kind of talked a little bit about, I guess, not wanting to only be known for your remixes. Do you see a difference between someone who is a remixer and a beat maker, or how would you describe that?
I guess a remixer, like, I feel like they would just get known by doing remixes, and when they make original songs, they would, like, people would care less. Like, that's how I feel about it sometimes, but I don't know, maybe I'm tripping. But mm-hmm. I was tripping at the time when I was saying, like, I don't want to be known as just a remixer because, you know, I was dropping, like, original music and people were not, you know, paying much attention and that kind of, like, I kind of got pissed about that because, like, I was making music for a while before like, the Janet Jackson remix dropped or the Tedra Moses remix dropped. But, I mean, there's not a big difference as long as you, like, you know, work your way throughout of it. Like, instead of, like, you can just continue to make original songs and people might forget it pretty much. Like I did with my album. Like, I just dropped the album and... nobody sees me. I mean, I don't know. I really don't know how I have to explain it, honestly, but yeah.
Do you listen to the remixes that people make of your music?
Sometimes I do. Like,
on SoundCloud, do you, like, search?
I don't search on SoundCloud, but, like, when I'm on my Facebook, I see, like, you know, like, I add anybody, you know, like, I used to have, like, I have, like, over 3,000 friends on Facebook, so, like, I see, like, bunch of random people just, like, posting their music on SoundCloud, and then I see my remixes, like, whatever, like, people remixing, like, Light Spots or whatever sound I did. So sometimes I'm impressed, sometimes I'm not, but yeah.
How does it feel to be on the other side of the remix?
It's crazy. It's still crazy. Like, I think, you know, that people get the chance to, like, see something different than I see it, and, you know, just not be afraid and show it, you know. Mm. So I think it's cool.
So I want to, you know, we'll get into the remixes in a little bit, but I think, you know, we're here in Montreal. This is some people's first time in Montreal. And maybe we can set the scene a little bit. I mean, you're born in Haiti, but you moved here when you're only a few months old. And you don't actually live in Montreal. You live in a suburb just outside of here called Saint-Hubert. Yeah. Did I say that right?
You said that.
Yes. can you tell us what it's like there?
It's a calm neighborhood. It's pretty calm. I love it here, like, living there. Like, nobody bothers you. Nobody knows where you are. So it's, like, it's pretty calm, and you get, like, it's mellow. I love it, you know. Like, I don't know when I'm going to leave this, like, Saint-Hubert town, but it's pretty cool. I love it. They have everything you want, too, like, but it's just, like, more mellow than it is in Montreal. Montreal is, like, overcrowded, but, you know, it's not that overcrowded. But, you know, It's the suburbs, you know?
So when you were a teenager and you're, like, into music, you're learning how to DJ and virtual DJ, like, what did you do? Like, how did you explore that? Is there anywhere in Saint-Hubert to, like, go listen to music or go? I mean, I guess you wouldn't have been buying music. Probably would have been downloading music. But, yeah, can you go hear live music anywhere?
My parents were very strict, so I couldn't go nowhere. I couldn't listen to music. Like, I listened to, like, whatever, like, nobody was listening to what I was listening to. So it was hard to find something that kind of matches what I was listening to at the time, in Saint-Hubert even. So, like, I couldn't go out since I was, like, 19 years old. So, like, the first time, like, I discovered, like, you know, the pew-pew scene and people listening to Madlib and all the beat makers, like, you know, Sam I Am, all my favorite beat makers, like Flying Lotus and all that. They were all listening to that type of music. And there were a lot of musicians making the same type of music as I was. So it was like sort of a relief to find that in Montreal. You know?
So you went out before you turned 19 and found this scene, the Pew Pew scene.
Yeah.
Can you tell everyone here specifically what it is?
The Pew Pew scene is... It's the beat scene. It's kind of like the same thing that was going on in LA, like the Low End Theory stuff, where there was just only like weird but crazy beats, you know, like experimental, whatever you want to go with it, you know, sampling and all that. It was just something fresh and new in Montreal for sure. So like that night, I did my first gig, I guess, you know. At the Artbeat Montreal, that's where the Pew Pew scene started. Artbeat Montreal is a collective slash, you know, they always make those events to, you know, bring producers from Quebec, you know, or Canada, or anywhere in Canada, you know, bring them into one spot and just, like, show each other, like, the beats, you know?
Who are some of those producers?
Some of them were Ken Lowe, High Classified, The P. But there were so many, like, series of them because, like, there were so much producers, you know? So I met a lot of people over there. So it really breakthrough, you know, for me, it breakthrough a lot. So, like, so I could see, like, there's other musicians out there using FL Studio and, you know, doing the similar beats as I was doing at the time. So
where did you fit in? I think, like, in an interview you've kind of talked about the different levels of Pew Pew.
Yeah.
So maybe break down the different levels and then talk about which level you were on.
I don't know. I guess I was on level one. Level one is just, like, I don't know. How can I say that? This Pew Pew thing was like, everybody was looking for the meaning of it, so, like, nobody knew what it really meant. But the guy who invented it, named V. Looper, shouts to him. He's from Quebec City, and he's like, we make pew-pew music, and it's just, like, we're live and direct. We're just making pew-pew music, and that's it. But a lot of people, like, took that pew-pew meaning and flipped it around, so it has a lot of meaning. So, like, everybody was just explaining their own, what they felt about Pew Pew, and it was kind of starting to get confusing, so I didn't know what to say sometimes. Like, when they interviewed me for that documentary that they was doing at the time, I was saying, like, Pew Pew level one is just, you know, normal beats, you know, just sampling, and Pew Pew level two is just, like, between, you know, the smooth drums and hip-hop, whatever, and with experimental sounds. And Pew Pew level three is just like the crazy you can get, the craziest you can get with, and the more creative you can be as a beat maker, you know. And that's how the Pew Pew was seen for me at the time. But now I don't see it that way. It's just a community, a family in Montreal that was just making beats. So
you talked about, or you mentioned, like, Low End Theory. In LA, there is also like Selection and HW&W. There's all of these different kind of beat scenes or collectives that were kind of growing at the same time as this one. You know, what do you think Montreal was doing different from those scenes?
I think Montreal, what they were doing different was the fact that they represented Quebec to the fullest. And, you know, there's like French rap over it. And that really sounded fresh. Like, it sounded dope. Like, this group named A La Claire Ensemble was like pretty much like the ones who came up with the pew pew sound, and they came up with the raps and everything. Plus Rigondon, that's what they call it. It's pretty much like, I don't know, like you're probably gonna hear a Mad Lib influence in there, but they rap like with pride with the Quebec accent and all that. And you know, it sounded dope. It was really something creative. And they were dropping albums for free, and you know, that kind of built their fan base by just the fact that they were dropping their stuff for free, and they're making so much good music. So I was really influenced by them, and yeah.
Okay, I want to play a song that I was told was the biggest song in Montreal around that time.
Yeah.
And it's a song, it's your song, actually.
Oh, yeah. Ooh.
That was your song?
Yeah.
From what?
For Kaytranada.
And what year did that song come out? Or did you put that out?
2013.
And it's called?
Holy Hole in a Donut.
So is that Pew Pew?
It's Pew Pew. But it was post, like, it was after, like, the Pew Pew thing was going on. Like I said, like, the guys, like, High Classified, the P, you know, they all brought, like, the trap in Pew Pew, you know, like the southern bounce, like on 140 BPM type of stuff. So, like, they kind of influenced me on that to just drop, like, to make trap music, you know, so. And they were doing differently as well, you know, not just, like, they kind of, like, I was really not into, like, none of these trap music, none of these trap racks, like Gucci Mane and everything. So I was really close-minded at the time, you know, I don't know why. But it's it really opened my eyes. Like, I didn't know there was so much bass on it too. Like, I don't know. It's weird. It's really weird why I was like close-minded to it. But it's like the freshest thing at the time, and there's so many parties made for that too. And it's a crazy. It was a crazy thing. It was fresh and new. And it was really like when the trap thing was happening as well. You know, in the beginning, in 2013, 2012 ish. So.
Maybe you weren't so into it because you were, like, more into R&B and stuff?
No, I was more into, like, I was more into beats, you know, like, you know, Dilla mm-hmm. and stuff like that, you know, like hip-hop, R&B as well, you know, but, and disco, and that was the only thing I was into, so.
Okay. All right, let's listen to... We gotta listen to it. I think we have to listen to the song.
Sure.
That was your remix of Janet Jackson's If.
Yes, it is.
How did things change for you after you made that song?
Everything changed after this remix. Everything. yeah, like, it really, like, how can I say that?
What was the first thing that changed?
The first thing that changed was my SoundCloud followers. You know what I mean? I was at, like, 3,000 followers or something like that. You know, I was already stoked to have 3,000 followers. And, you know, overnight, you know, I made that, like, at 4 or 5 a.m., you know, coming from a flying notice show. And I was so inspired. Like, I think it was a time I was like, Kevin, you need to stop playing and be creative and be, like, your own sound. Because I was, like, copying Dilla, Madlib, trying to imitate them all the time. And for some reason, like, I don't know what really pushed me to do this remix and why did I make it housey. Like, before it was, like... Like, this beat was very, like, 90 BPM, very slow, very, like, something like that. But I try to put it best. I'm like, oh, stuff, like, oh, like, this is, like, I added the swing, like, and you know, for a housey beat, you know, like I never heard that before in some way. Or we don't get to hear that often. So I guess like for me, it was like, yo, this is like the flyest ish ever. I was so confident that it was like sort of the flyest shit ever at the time, you know. But it's just the fact that it sounds so new and so fresh and like all those up-tempo R&B, whatever, new soul, it kind of felt that way. And then I just posted on SoundCloud because I was like, you know what, I'm just going to do it. And then like I slept, you know, at the time I was sleeping like at 4 a.m., 5 a.m. and I would wake up at like 4 in the afternoon, you know. So that was like the times I was sleeping late. And then I was getting a bunch of notifications, you know, like my notifications on the iPhone was on. So I was just getting like nonstop notifications like your sound, like your sound, like your sound, blah, 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 like your sound on SoundCloud. So I was like, what is going on right now? Like is my remix blowing up or something? Then like I see like that getting more likes than usual. And I was like, oh snap, this is crazy. Went back to sleep for 4 more hours and then woke back again. Then I see even more likes. And I realized that, you know, it was like this Majestic Casuals. Majestic Casual. And some other account named Tiffany Zoo or something like that. They were just posting stuff on their YouTube channels and they had a lot of subscribers. So that kind of like made me big. And I didn't get to upload the Lady remix, the Mojo Lady remix after that. And then I stopped doing it for a while. And then for some reason I was working the TJ Moses Be Your Girl remix for like 3 months. Because I didn't know like what snare, what the right snare or whatever, like the right claps or whatever. I think I couldn't find that. So I just sat on it till February. And then I dropped that and it was like another banger, like if. And, you know, I was like, okay, this might be it. This might be, you know, the time, I guess. You know, this new sound, I'm going to, like, run with that and try to, like, come up with some new-ish, I guess, you know. So I guess the up-tempo, like, R&B-ish, like, was kind of, like, hot at the time. Very fresh, very new, and, you know, a lot of people, like, was inspired to do it. So, yeah.
Is that track still important to you after all the other stuff you've accomplished since putting out If?
To be honest, it is very, very, very important track. You know, if I don't play it in my sets, you know, I know the fans are going to be so disappointed. So it's like the last song I always play in my sets. And, you know, I can't deny it that the fact that this song is like a hit for people and it's like the song that people like lose their mind to. I don't see it as, I think I made better productions, of course, but you know, I guess this is the one that people like the most. And you know, I guess I'm gonna run with that for the rest of my life, but it's okay, you know.
It is the song that like had Madonna calling you and Janet's people calling you and
yeah.
Who else called you?
Madonna and Janet called me, yeah. Madonna called me, like, I guess Madonna called me because she heard, like, other stuff, like, Leave Me Alone and all the other stuff with it. And who else called me? I can't remember who else called me.
Someone called you recently, Andre 3000.
Yeah.
From Outkast. You were in the studio with him this past weekend.
Yeah. But I don't think that's the song that I called him. But he's no, like, no. But
that's, it's been 5 years, so.
Yeah, yeah. But he told me, like, he really like how I program my drums. Like, I guess it was more of a serious thing. Like, he knows, like, the swing and stuff. Like, even when he raps, like, he has the swing. I think, like, when you have the swing and you recognize, like, you know, swing, recognize swing. You know, if you're a rapper, you know, like, and you, like, got, like, this funky, like bounce or whatever, like, how you perform it. You know, like, Anderson .Paak does it, like, we're definitely gonna click, you know. Like, I think, like, there's not a lot of rappers that way, you know. So, Andre recognized it, Anderson .Paak recognized it, and there's much more as well, you know. Mick Jenkins and, you know, my bro as well, Lou Phelps, you know. A lot of, like, you just have to recognize swing pretty much. So, Yeah.
Swing, recognize, swing.
Swing, recognize,
hashtag
swing.
Hashtag swing, recognize.
Yeah.
There, so, you know, these people who we all know have called you or have wanted to work with you. But there are some people you've worked with and they've worked with you. You guys have done stuff for each other's records. One of them, or I guess a few of them, it's the internet and specifically Sid the Kid. Let's listen to one of the tracks that you worked on from the internet album called Girl. How did you guys make that song?
I sent her the beat and she sent me. Pretty much like I sent her the beat and then she, you know, and then they did their thing on it, you know.
How did you connect with Sid and the internet? How did that happen?
I connected with Sid and the crew in Croatia. That was like in Dimensions Festival. There was like a huge storm going on. I didn't get to play my whole set, like 15 minutes, and it was like storm and just shut down the whole festival. So we had to like stop it there. And they were like in the background, like, yo, like you just shut the whole festival down, you know? But it's, yeah, that's how we connected pretty much. And before that, you know, they were following me on Twitter and you know,
and SoundCloud.
It's yeah, of course. And to me, it was like I was like mind blown. Like wow, like you know, like I'm a fan of the internet. So yeah, it was pretty huge, pretty crazy.
Why is that relationship important to you?
Cause you know, like Sid is like one talented motherfucker. You know, like the whole like the internet crew, like. They have so much soul and, you know, and there's not a lot of bands out there that has soul like them, you know, like, you know, nowadays it's not, you know, really common to find that. So pretty much the internet has their own sound and, you know, and they, you know, it's sick. It's just sick, you know, it's music that connects people together and that's what happened.
You guys, share common influences too, like the Neptunes and
yeah, the Neptunes for sure, like NERD and all that. Yeah.
And you're also, I mean, sorry. Yeah, you're also a big fan of Dilla and Madlib. We've kind of talked about that a little bit too. I want to talk a little bit about why you love Kareem Riggins, though.
No, he's funky, man. He's really funky, like. And he's like a sick drummer as well. And
he played drums on this album for
yeah,
you.
Yeah, Bus Ride, which I did River Tiber as well, you know, in the house. Yeah, make some noise for River Tiber band. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So we made that joint together and yeah, it's crazy.
Well, what makes Kareem's drum special to you?
Because, you know, he makes beats as well, so... You know, a lot of drummers don't, you know, just play drums and that's it, you know. And he, I guess, put the snare as loud as he can and adds the swing that we need and all that. So it's pretty much that.
Okay, let's listen to another producer. Two artists, actually, that you really love. A song that we both love that we talked about loving. coming to
you loud. I get the chills. Woo. Madlib and Erykah Badu. The Healer. That's like one of my favorite songs, man. Like, for real. It's my favorite artist as well.
Why is it one of your favorite songs?
I don't know. When I first heard it, I'm like, yo, like, the beat is banging, you know? And the fact that an R&B singer could just, like, sing on like, hip-hop beats, it's always an amazing thing. Like, that's why I love Mary J. Blige so much, and that's why I love Erykah Badu so much. It's just, like, stuff that bangs, you know, like hip-hop stuff, but, you know, it adds a twist, like, to the R&B, I guess, you know, so.
And that song is dedicated to JD.
Yeah, pretty much.
The man, so it's, Dilla. Like, everything that you love.
Exactly. That's pretty much defines what I am. musically.
When did you first get into Dilla?
I got into Dilla like because of Tropical Quest. And I discovered, like, right after he passed away, of course, you know, but I was listening to his production without knowing him, knowing it was, like, him on the beats, you know. Find a Way is my favorite track from Tribe. So, and I didn't know he produced it at the time, and I was like, oh, like in 2006, I remember, like, everybody saying, like, J Dilla passed away, and I'm like, who's J Dilla? Like, and I feel so stupid to say that, but I was like, who is J Dilla? So I just, like, did my research, and then found that he produced, like, The Far Side and Tribe and, you know, who else did he do? He did Bus, of course.
Slum Village.
Slum V, of course. Yeah, Slum V. How can I forget Slum V? You know, so many artists that he produced that I was listening to, and I was like, you know, I only knew Just Blaze and the Neptunes at the time. So, yeah.
I think the interesting thing about Dilla, too, is that he was able to do all that heavy, like, kind of music nerd stuff, but then also do a song like Vibrant Thing.
Yeah, Vibrant Thing.
By Q-Tip.
Yeah, Club Bangers. He could do whatever he wanted to. There's, like, his, like, one of his latest tape before he passed away, like, in 2005, called 64 Beats or whatever. And it's only Club Bangers, you know. Probably made for Busta Rhymes and all those type of artists. And it bangs so much. It's just the fact that it's so crazy. It's just that it's Club Bangers, but he's flipping samples as well. So that kind of influenced me, and it still influenced me to this day to just, like, flip samples, but make it hot at the same time and not only traditional boom bap joints, you know? So
you just went to Brazil.
Yep.
For a few days, and you went shopping.
Yep.
And you brought some stuff to play for us.
Yeah.
Speaking of sampling.
This is not the only thing I brought, of course, but I had to come back with the luggage. But yeah, there's a lot of stuff I discovered, like, that I eventually flipped. Recently.
Why did you want to go to Brazil?
I mean, I always wanted to go to Brazil because I was, you know, I'm a Madlib fan. And Madlib did a lot of, like, mixes. Brazilian music. With only Brazilian music. And to me, it's like folk, rock, psychedelic, and, you know, not disco, but, like, samba, bossa nova, all that type of jazzy stuff that comes from Brazil. And I don't know, there's something about Brazil that is, like, sound gritty, you know, sound raw, and, like, straight to your, like, face. And so soulful, way more soulful, and way more progressive than just soul music, you know? So, I don't know, it kind of touched me, like, in my heart, like, damn, like, those music are so soulful. Like, it makes me, like, I don't know, cry, or, I don't know. It's crazy. It's just the best type of music that I could find. Like, since I discovered Madlib when I was younger, that was like another thing that kind of, like, opened the door for me to, like, just hear other types of music, which is, like, Brazilian MPB, like, from the 1970s and all that type of stuff.
So, like, Madlib is really the one who inspired you to, like, start digging, looking for samples?
Yeah. Like, I mean,
even Brazil, on YouTube and stuff.
I mean, YouTube, of course, but, you know, everybody goes to YouTube in some way, you know. But the fact that I was in Rio, and they gave me this, I went to this thing called Supernut or whatever, like Supernut Records, something like that, and it's only appointment only, and I spent like 10 hours in there. My brother kept calling me, like, when are you coming back? so I really spent, like, the whole day just trying to, like, listen to records, trying to discover something new, trying to discover more stuff to sample or just stuff to listen to, pretty much. And yeah.
Okay, so show us what you found.
I found Milton Nascimento. You know, like, classic. It's pretty, like, stupid of me because I was always, like, overshadowed. He was always, for me, overshadowed by, you know, Marcos Valle and, you know, Edu Lobo and, you know, Gal Costa and all those, like, all those people. like artists. But Milton Nascimento is like this record that I found. He's pretty popular, but to me it's like when I heard that on the record, like as you can see, like the record is it's the bomb. Like how it's packaged. But yeah. It's really dope. And it's quadraphonic, as they say, quadraphonic, but it's surround sound, like, but I don't, it's only stereo, but it's pretty dope. Yeah, and I'm gonna show you this beat that I flipped way recently. Nah, that's not the one. Thank you. Yeah, man. So that's what I did when I came back home from Brazil, listening to all those records and trying to make a little tape for myself. You know, a little
kind of like a beat conductor thing.
Yeah, I'm very inspired by the beat conductor himself. So Madlib, yeah. Yeah, this record I forgot to bring it, but it's pretty much, it's a dope one. I wish I could show you the original sample, but yeah, it's pretty dope. So yeah, that's what I did.
What's Black Tropical House?
Oh. Black Tropical House is the 99.9% sound, I guess. Honestly, Black Tropical House, I came up with that tweet just to prove a point. You know, everybody's like, what type of music you doing? What do you think you're doing? Like, what are you doing? I'm like, you know, I guess Black Tropical House, you know. Because, you know, I come from Haiti where, you know, very Caribbean influences and everything that I do like has like this percussions, I guess, you know. So, and I take the Kaigo, you know, meaning, you know, and flip around. And I guess, you know, Kaigo is like the head, the guy who makes the tropical house, as we call it, mainly. But I guess I put a flip on it to say Black Tropical House because my stuff is pretty like Black music sounding, you know. I don't want to make it a race thing, but you know, when there was a time when it's called Black music, I took from that in the 70s and put Black Tropical House because my stuff has more swing to it, you know, than just how it cannot only be house music only. So there's like the swing and there's like the soul in it. So I guess the Black Tropical House meaning comes from that, but you know, it's just some stupid tweet I wrote. Really, honestly. But it was just to prove a point, you know, like, it was just to prove a point.
I think I was also reading that you and Matt Martians from the internet kind of talk about what it means to be, like, Black men making the kind of music that you make, or maybe specifically making house music. Do you want to talk about that a little?
Yeah, because I guess mainly, like, you would guess that with the type of music I'm making... with the type of music I'm making, it's more like it comes from, like, I don't know. It's weird to explain that because house music, you see mostly the most known house DJs are pretty much like white people and like white DJs and stuff like that, or, you know, and that's how it is. But just the fact that just because of a genre, you have to make some type of music. Even growing up, like being Black, like you would probably like you, people would look at you weird because you're not listening to hip hop or something like that, or you're into like, you know, emo music or whatever, like or that type of music. Like you wouldn't see like, I guess, a Black man listen to that because like that's what this society made it seem. But at the end of the day, it's just music, you know. It's only music because, like, you know, you see NERD making rock music, pure rock music that has like a little soul R&B element, but it's mainly rock, you know. So I guess that's the best example I can give it to you. Like, pretty much. And the internet, like, you know, Matt from the internet, so said that it's hard for us to be, you know, as black musicians, we're supposed to make hip hop and, you know, and stuff like that, which is not true. At the end of the day, music is music. And I guess society, like, while growing, like, at the time, made us seem that you can only make that type of music, you know, but which is whatever. But yeah. I probably talk too much. I don't know what I'm saying.
No.
But yeah.
You mentioned the Haitian music that you listened to in the house growing up.
Yep.
And I want to give people a sense of maybe what that sounds like. And you can introduce this song because you know what it is.
Kassav, yeah. Like
Zoukla. Should we play it first?
Yeah, just play it first because it's the hot-ish. This one is by Kassav. Zoukla, c'est seul médicament nous ni.
What does that mean?
The music is the only medicine that we need. Something like that. But I'm sure they mean Zouk, but I'm not sure if they mean the genre of Zouk, but, you know, I guess. But this song is, like, very, like, it's a, you know, family reunion. Like, if you don't play that song, like, something's wrong with you, like, I guess. Because, like, every party I've been to growing up, like, they've been playing this song. But I really love that song. That's, like, yeah, one of my favorites.
Can you tell people what Zouk is? Huh? Can you tell people what Zouk is?
Zouk is is this genre of like, ballad-ish. Probably inspired by, you know, the, like, around the Caribbean and, you know, Haitian music. But I guess it has a flip of French in it, too. But, you know, it's not only, like, I thought it came from Haiti at the time. Because, like, it was just, my dad and my mom used to play that a lot. So, but it's from the Caribbeans, mostly. And it's, like, ballads, pretty much.
And then there's also compa, which is also Haitian, right?
Yeah, compa is like pure Haitian music.
What's compa?
Compa is the same drum pattern, like, you know, like Sweet Mickey, like, you know, even Wyclef. You hear Wyclef albums, he always has a compa song in it. Like, yeah, it's pretty much like the most bangable thing for Haitians, you know, like it's like the go-to music for Haitians.
What does it sound like? What's the rhythm like?
The same drum pattern, like, it's like sort of like not reggaeton, but like it has the same like vibe, like, and it's like, it's always like over 15 minutes too, because like they made it over 15 minutes too for you to get yourself a girl to dance on the dance floor for it, you know, like, or get you someone to dance to, pretty much for that. So, yeah, it's the go-to music for Haitians.
So this is what you were listening to in your house growing up?
Yeah, you know, like, honestly, like, I didn't like, because it was so, like, in my ears all the time, I was so, like, enough, but I respect it today, but at the time growing up, I was, like, I was not into it at all, because it was just too much, you know, too much of it. And my dad was like, listen to it. And I'm like, no, dad, like, I want to listen to rap. I want to listen to Jay-Z. I want to listen to Dipset, you know, like. And, you know, my dad was like always complaining for us to not listen to compa and listen to hip-hop instead. So, yeah.
And what do you think you, like, took from that music into your music today? I mean, like, a song like Light Spots on your album is sampling Brazilian music. Is there any, like, overt Haitian references on 99.9%?
There was supposed to be, like, I'm gonna play this song that was supposed to be on the album, but I guess they didn't want to get the sample cleared. But it was very, like, Haitian influence. And I can't really think of, like, this 99.9% song that is, like, Haitian influence. Bunch of them of it. Like, even Leave Me Alone has, like, it's, like, Brazil, Africa, and, like, Haiti, like, all in one to me. So it's pretty much that. Let me play the song that was supposed to be on the album. It's a dope one. Yeah, they change. It's not nice. Ooh la la. Let me find this one. Breezy. Thank you.
What was the song you sampled there?
Yeah, this song is called, that I sampled, it's called Petit Garçon Fais Respect, which means little man, respect yourself. And it's a banger. It used to be a banger back in the day in Haiti. And I guess there was like, when I heard that sample like recently, like I was like, man, like there's so many like dope elements that they were using. Like I guess those drum sounds, like the land drums and all that, but it was using like the Haitian way, you know, like it's so different. And I was like mind blown by that, you know. Yeah, it was really funky as well. And I wanted to flip that and trying to like make a little tribute to like myself listening to compa music. But it didn't make the album because the sample can get cleared and it didn't like what I did with the beat. So that's what happens when you sample a lot. But yeah.
Okay, I think it's time for some questions from the audience. Thank you for that. Oh. We're gonna take some questions.
Okay, for sure.
Oh yeah, and we need a mic. Sorry, but I can. Is there a mic? Going? Yes.
Second time. Good evening.
Hi.
I wanted to know if you heard the album Seeds by Georgia Ann Muldrow and what you think of it both musically and conceptually.
I think it's a dope album. And the funny story about it is that I met Georgia Ann when she was in Montreal, like giving signings for the album.
Nice.
At Off the Hook. And I was like, oh, so like I was so happy to meet her at the time. It was like back in 2012 when it came out, and I had like $0 on me, you know. So I was like, oh, I really want to buy the album. Like I was talking to her. She was doing meet and greets over there, and I was like talking to her, and I was like telling her like, oh, I really want the album, but I don't have money. And she was like, it's only $15. It's only $15. I'm like, I'm really broke right now. Like I'm really broke, and then. Eventually, she gave me the CD autograph sign, and she said stay humble, stay, you know, be powered, be like whatever, like be enlightening to Kevin or whatever. And I'm like, damn, man, she really gave me a signed copy of the Seeds album, and yeah, it's a dope album. And the way it was mixed is very like weird how it was mixed. Like even if you put the bass too loud, like it's gonna be like. How it should be. I don't know. It's a weird science on that mixing, how this album was mixed. But anyway, very good album.
Thanks. Yeah, I think she's really underappreciated.
Yo, for real.
Yeah, she's thank you.
Dope producer as well. Yeah.
Hey, what was the first song you ever sampled?
First song I ever sampled? Earth, Wind, and Fire, September. Yeah. I made a little banger, like a little like... Yeah, little house banger with that at the time. So yeah.
Do you still have it?
Damn.
He's asking like he knew.
I don't know if I have it, but I wish I did. Oh. Look at the Jackson looking through the windows? No one can judge us. The jazz joint, Mr. Scruff, whatever. No, it's not Mr. Scruff. But like, I don't consider that as the first sample, because like I don't remember. I don't know. But I pretty much like dun, dun, dun. Oh, anyway. But that was like okay. Let's say that Earth, Wind, and Fire was the second sample I ever did in my life.
Wait, how old were you when you made that? The first sample.
I was 15.
Oh.
I was 15 when I first sampled.
What up?
What up, Mayan?
Just a quick question. So just wondering, you probably get a lot of music from other people who make music like you, and you probably get a whole bunch of stuff in your emails. And I wanted to know, is it an interest for you to like build like a team or something like in the future?
Yeah, of course. Like, I always had this idea to like build this like record label, and like, you know, a lot of music that I discover that is not known, I want to like put people on the map sometimes, you know. I like to work with people that is not, you know, not super known sometimes, and it could be challenging. I already did that in my career, and like, I think it's dope. But later on, when I'm gonna be like, I guess, older and settled down and whatever, I'm probably gonna like try to open a record label for myself, and you know, for the people that I'm trying to like put on. And I'm already trying to do that with How and Where Records in some way, but it's harder than it is. But to just discover somebody, like, it's really hard. You always gotta like keep your eyes open. But yeah, you know.
Thank you.
One day.
Hey man, thanks for coming in and speaking with us today. My question is, how have you found sampling change in the way that artists find samples and the way that artists use samples now, from when you started producing to like the last records you just bought in Brazil?
What was it, the question? Like,
how have you seen the use of sampling change over time, essentially?
I don't think it really changed. I think it's like, by like at the time when I first discovered sampling, I didn't know about chopping samples, I guess, you know. That's the only thing that kind of like I guess moved on to another level of sampling, and just, you know, chop samples and trying to create a new melody out of it, like, you know, like Dilla does it, you know, on Donuts, like how he did Airworks, like I don't know how he flipped that. But at the same time, like the way I sample stuff, sometimes it can be challenging. Like, I would love to like take off the vocals, so I guess to EQ some stuff a lot so that I won't hear vocals anymore. And it's like a science around the stereo type of sounds, you know. Like when you come, I don't know, it's a weird way to explain that. When you like play with the stereo and the left and the right, sometimes you get to hear the background of the music. I don't know, like example, like, you know, Wanna Be Starting Something. When I was young, I discovered that with my brother. Like, we had broken headphones and we were just playing like Thriller off the CD player, like the CD Walkman. And you could, just because the headphones were kind of broken, you could only hear like the shakes and like the bass line and just the background vocals of it. Like, you know, yeah. You just hear like, you don't get to hear the vocals, like the main vocals. So it's a weird sign sometimes, like the stereo thing. But that's what I discovered, and that's how I sample my stuff as well. Sometimes, you know, I guess it's like not everybody knows that, but you know, it's a weird way to explain. And I wish I could show you, but it's gonna take me a while. But yeah,
cool. Thank you.
Hi. I was wondering, like, what do you think of funky in Brazil? Funky, you know, baile funk, or how? It's known by so many names. I don't know how to call it, but like, I find it so interesting the way that the Brazilian people like got this Miami bass music and early hip hop and stuff, and they kind of made it their own. With the tools that they have had available. And I was wondering, like, for you being from Haitian descent and Canadian, kind of being a bit outside the mainstream, like American hip hop kind of world, like, how do you feel about incorporating the different sounds and in relation to that kind of Brazilian music also? Like, if you like this music, if you feel like there's a connection between what you do and what they did back then?
I think they do it differently in some way. But I can feel like there's a lot of elements that that's kind of similar at the same time. You know, like Bali funk probably used like, I don't know where they found their doop cha cha ka doop cha cha. They probably like recorded it themselves or chop, like just chop it themselves or just recorded it and just add bass to it. And just the fact that it's a rhythm that is very like diverse and I don't know. It's, yeah. It's pretty similar pretty much, like, because they use their own voices and they sample their own voices and they just add a bass line to it. But yeah. Compared to like my sound or the Haitian sounds, I don't think like in Haiti there is like a sound that is like more for clubs except the rah-rah movement and the house music, which is like sort of like similar to the house music, you know, the tropical house normal. But yeah, that's how I feel about it. Any more questions?
I just had a question. So the first song of yours that I really loved and stood out to me, it was obviously a little bit later in your career, was At All. And one of the things that really caught me off guard with it was how it really goes through so many evolutions and it has a lot of progress. When you're making music, is that something that you're thinking consciously about being like, okay, I want to make sure that every so often I'm totally shifting the direction of the song, or is it something that is just sort of organic and happens as you flow through the production?
I guess it happens organically or something like that, because I guess I don't want to make it like, you know, if I made At All and it would just be a loop like over and over, it wouldn't be that interesting. So I just love to add a little twist to it or something like that. Even the evolution, like adding chords and adding bass lines instead of using the samples bass line, could be more interesting. And yeah, so for me, it's like, it's really important to just, how can I say? It's really important for me to just not do just a loop of sampling and just add a little twist to it and make it more of a song than just a thing that you can easily remix or something like that, trying to like trick people and before they do it, you know, or something like that. But yeah, that's how I see it.
Hi.
What up, man?
Not much. How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
I don't really have any questions. I just want to say hi.
Cool. How you doing?
I've been good, man.
Cool.
How's it feel overall?
Everything
that's happened over the past few years.
It's been great. It feels great, man. A lot of fans. You know, it's crazy. It's wild.
That's all.
You cool. Just,
we'll talk later.
Shout out.
You actually just won the Polaris Music Prize.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, I did. Yeah. Boom. Yeah. Thank you.
You're the first Black artist to win the Polaris Music Prize in the prize's history, which, you know, has been kind of a thing that we have talked about here in the Canadian music industry for a while. I mean, in general, though, how does it feel to be recognized with something like that?
It feels great because, to be honest, like, how the Canadian music scene was really, like, seen, it was just, like, I don't know. Like, I don't want to say, like, I have nothing against, like, folk music or, you know, everybody playing, you know, doing, like, country and stuff like that. But in Canada, I guess they were saying, it was only, like, this type of music that would be on the radio and, you know, rap music would be less played or whatever, you know, and your house music or electronic music. So to be recognized by the Polaris for, like, you know, as art as well, it's pretty crazy because, you know, you would probably expect something pop to win, you know, or something like country or rock or, you know, hilly billy or rock and roll or something like that, you know. It's, to me, it's like, yeah, it's good because they finally recognize, you know, like R&B, house, rap, you know, all in one.
All, actually, a lot of different genres in, all in one album.
Exactly. Yeah. So, and yeah, it's pretty crazy to me that they recognized it. And
earlier this year, you called the Canadian music scene out of touch, though. You tweeted that.
Yeah, yeah I did.
That was because of a nomination for the Juno Awards being disqualified.
Yeah.
Do you still feel that way now that you have your award?
I mean, less than I used to, I guess, you know. But the reason why I said that is just the fact that they recognized at all, like in 2015 or 16, is it 2016, right? Yeah, 2016, yeah. Junos, yeah, in 2016. Because the fact that, because at all came out in 2013, and this is like 3 years later, they recognized it like as a single, you know, like. For me, like, they could have used Leave Me Alone. They could have used Drive Me Crazy that came out 2015, you know? But they used At All because At All has a music video, something like that. But it's like, why would they put it on 2015 and then say, oh, my bad, False Alarm? So to me, it's like, why is it in 2016 or 15 that you recognize At All when it came out 2013? You know what I mean? And that's why I feel like it's out of touch, because they would nominate like only big names, you know, without even listening to the music or something like that. I feel like it's more of a popularity contest like Grammys did, you know, like that's how I saw it, you know. And I hope they see it differently now, because I just did that weird rant on Twitter, like the out of touch thing, you know. But it was just to prove a point, like, and, you know, I don't think I'm the only one feeling that way, of course, you know, like, I've been talking to people over the years about how the Canadian music scene is, but, you know, that's how I see it. Yeah.
Is there any more questions? Yes.
Hi. Congratulations on the Polaris.
Thank you.
Now that you've won an award and more or less got a wider recognition throughout the country, at least, do you feel the need to like one up yourself in your next work, or do you just like let your music carry you away where it wants to go?
It's pretty much like I let the music carry me like where it wants to go.
Regardless of the award.
Yeah. I mean, to me, like, I always, like, I still plan to do a second album and trying to elevate as well, trying to be better at what I do every day or something like that, you know? And, you know, and organically, like, I let the music, you know, I'm not trying to force myself to do this or do that, you know? Sometimes I do, but when I do that, it's always a fail, you know? It's always, like, it turns out to not be the best thing, so... So now I understood that you have to like be, you know, organic, and you know if their inspiration can be here, you know, you cannot force it, because it's gonna be whack any of the day. It's not gonna be good. So it's better to let the music, you know, carry it away.
Okay, but do you feel the pressure of winning an award and feel like where everyone has like this kind of expectation of what are you going to do next that will blow their mind, or you know something like that?
I don't know. I don't think it's gonna that really change, I guess, like the way, I don't know. I really don't know. Like to me, it's like, it's so hard to explain. It's like, I won't let an award, like, yes, like, you know, go that up to my head so I can just be better at what I do or something like that. But it's, I don't know, it's so hard to explain. Damn. How can I put that? To me, like, to win an award, it definitely encourages me to do more music. It doesn't make me, I guess, better or whatever. Like, whatever is going to happen in the future, we'll see about that. But I won't let that, you know, like go that up to my head and, you know, expecting for people to get better music or something like that, you know. It is going to be what it's going to be at the end of the day. You know, it's just music is music. So, yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Oh, another question over there.
No questions?
No, there is.
Yeah. Hey. I was wondering, do you still think that you truly found your sound, or do you still think that there's more to dig into and there's some things that you can work on?
I did think I found my sound, like when I did the If Janet Jackson thing, you know, and a lot of people like took that style and, you know, kind of ran with it and, you know, but now I'm trying to like build a new sound. Like it could be like an evolution of what I was doing, something like that. And that's how I see it, you know. Now I'm more into drum breaks and stuff like that and trying to like, or trying to do new Jack Swing, you know, something like that, trying to bring it back. And, but in my own way, you know, it's hard to explain, you know. It's like I was doing the If and the Kaytranada sound that they saw at the time, you know, like in 2013. But now it's like a more evolution thing. Like even with 99.9%, I don't feel like it's what I'm doing now, you know. So it's been like 2 years I've been working on this record. So in 2014, that was pretty much the sound I was into. But now I'm into totally something different.
Do you still think like there's some things that you can work on that's better, and what would it be?
Oh, totally. Like I still don't think I'm like the most perfect musician. I still like trying to like try to sample less and trying to like create more trying to like create my own stuff. But it's hard when you don't know how to play the piano or whatever. Like when you forgot how to play the piano, of course, you know. But I guess you know, like you know sounds by ear. I know I can hear chords by ear. So like I take my time and just to find the right composition. But yeah, but I even like collaborate with more people to be inspired and stuff like that. You know, like with Bad Bad Not Good, there's so many stuff we made. River Tiber as well. And yeah, pretty much that. More original music I'm trying to do than just sampling.
Perfect. Thank you.
Okay.
I have a question. Do we have someone else? What advice would you give to musicians who were trying to work with someone else on a collaboration just to have like a more fluid creative flow?
The advice I will give to musician, I guess, is don't let nobody tell you what to do, I guess. You know, like, don't let nobody, have your creative control. Like, make sure you have that with you because, you know, people will treat you like a puppet and make you do something that you don't want to do and stuff like that. And you will not be happy at the end of the day if you're not making what you want. And also with collaborating with artists, make sure the artists like love your music. Make sure the artist knows what you're trying to do. Do not do a forced collaboration. Do not try to collab with someone who's not really into you. Don't waste your time, you know. You can't be a fan of someone. Just because you're a fan of someone doesn't mean you have to work with them, you know, in some way. So, yeah, make sure that person fucks with you first, you know, so yeah.
Okay, I think that wraps up our time here. Thank you so much for this.
No problem.